Let's give God some praise and some glory this morning. Come on, he's worthy of the praise. This is the day that the Lord has made. Have you come to rejoice? Have you come to be glad in it? Come on, I want to invite you to jump to your feet. Come on, the Lord deserves that this morning. Come on and clap.
Sanctuary, have thine own way in the sanctuary. please bow your heads and close your eyes for prayer. Dear Lord, I first would like to thank you for being you. Thank you for loving us and caring for us. We acknowledge that you are the one true King, and we praise you for that. God, I ask that you will heal the sick, those that are emotionally sick, mentally sick, and physically sick. I ask that you may touch Aunt Jackie and heal her body, Lord. Touch her family, touch us, her church family. Give us courage and trust so she knows and we know that she is in your hands and always has been in your hands. Lord, I pray that you be with our church. Speak to us, Lord, that we may hear you and act accordingly. Give us clarity so we know it's you. Be with those that will be attending school this fall. Help them to make the right decisions and right choices. And I know we fall, Lord, so even if we don't make the best choices, help us to bounce back. Bring us back to you. In your holy name, amen.
Glad in it. My name is Paul Simons. I'm also a proud member of the class of 2021. Even in my advanced years, I have just received my master's degree. Thank you. I'm also the proud father of Tajay Simons, who is on the other end of the spectrum, having just graduated from kindergarten. So I'm indeed very happy to be here. I'm elated, I'm overjoyed to see you all here. I thank you for coming, and welcome. We are here to celebrate today the class of 2021. You have made tremendous strides towards your future, and you could not have done that without family, friends, teachers, loved ones. As a matter of fact, can I see all our parents? Can we stand up, all our family members? Any family members around? Give yourselves a round of applause. You may be seated. And that is a remarkable achievement during these times. The last 2 years have been pandemic. You have had to convert your homes into classrooms, your bedrooms into classrooms, your bathrooms into principal's office. Well, maybe I'm just speaking for myself. But, you know, you really have done an excellent job, and you're to be commended for it. My students, my fellow classmates, this is an achievement that you should take a snapshot of in your mind and remember it forever. It doesn't matter if you're coming from kindergarten to high school, to college, to your graduate degree, to your doctorate, you'll remember this forever, and no one can ever take it away from you. Take a snapshot of that in your mind and keep it there forever and ever. But what is really important for us to recognize at this time is that this is, in fact, the day that the Lord has made. So when we ascend to these high heights, we have to bring ourselves right back to the center and remember that this day God made for us to achieve the things that we have achieved. And without God first making the day for us, we could not achieve the things that we have achieved thus far. So having said that, I congratulate everyone, parents, teachers, extended family, everyone. Well done, well done, well done. Now, without further ado, I wish to introduce Pastor Damon E. Hendrickson. And it's interesting because I'm Paul E. Simons, and you have Owen E. Simons as well. I guess, you know, we have something in common. Maybe the E stands for excellence. I don't know. Maybe. But nevertheless, Pastor Damon E. Hendrickson. Thank you.
Hey, graduates. Although I couldn't physically be there with you today, I wanted to send you my virtual greeting and tell you congratulations. Whether you're graduating from kindergarten, middle school, high school, college, or postgraduate, we at Restoration want to commend you for a job well done. That's right, you have continued to persevere in your educational matriculation. You have continued to persevere in your intellectual matriculation. And I want to encourage you to continue to persevere in your spiritual matriculation. That's right, I not only want you to continue to celebrate this grand graduation occasion, but I want you to continue to celebrate your growth in Christ. And so on behalf of my wife and the leadership team at Restoration Ministries and your entire Restoration family, we commend you. We congratulate you on a job well done. But guess what, y'all? The job's not finished. The job is not finished. While you have achieved academic excellence, we look forward to two words that'll let us know that we've achieved spiritual excellence, and that's well done. On that great day, on that great morning, well done from Jesus Christ. So continue to grow spiritually, continue to grow academically, and I know that God will bless your path. The Bible says, trust in the Lord in all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him. And here's the important part, He'll direct your path. Trust God, y'all, and He will direct your path to the next step that He would have you take. God bless you, Pastor D. I'm super proud of each and every one of you. May you have a great day, and once again, happy graduation.
Good afternoon, all. As we know, this is the day that we are honoring our 2021 graduates. And very quickly, as we call your name, we would like to present you with just a small token. And we're going to go from kindergarten all the way up to law school. Yeah. It's going to be great. We first would like to call Daniel Hinkson, graduating from kindergarten at Bermuda Institute. And you can assemble on this side. Congratulations, Daniel. You can come this way and off that way. He may need a little help. That's a big gift. We would like a representative for Maze Darrell. Maze Darrell also graduated from kindergarten at Bermuda Institute. Then a representative for Tajay Simons. That would be you, yes, Paul. Then we have graduating from primary school, going on to middle school, Aaron Wales. From middle school, going on to high school, we have Landon Holder. He's going to figure that out, right? Then we have Taylor Dean. We're going to ask Mr. Simons to come off of the organ and present this last one from middle school going to high school. We have none other than Miss Lene Lowe.
Good morning, everyone. In addition to Lene's gifts and stuff, we would also like to present to her from Bermuda Institute, which was omitted at the graduation, Outstanding Community Service Award that she received with over 300 hours.
Thank you, Mr. Simons. Congratulations, Lene Lowe. I'll pass it on to our youth ministries.
All right, continuing with high school, we have Satori Smith. We have India Sharinarayan. We have Giel Bean. We have Javen Iris. We have Dakota Tucker. We have Justin Eben. We have Dominique Douglas. And Jaden Coleman. To college and university, we have James Greenfield. We have Micah O'Brien. And we have Paul Simons. And we did miss one from high school. Charge it to our heads and not our heart. We do have Indio Francis as well. Make sure we get something to you. And we just want to say congratulations to all of our graduates and the hard work that you put in. And we gave you something spiritual, but also something tangible that you can spend. So once again, thank you and great work.
Your graduation day finally came. Your dreams you did pursue. All your hard work and prayer and prayers have paid off, and we are so very proud of you. The nights of study, the projects due, you did them all by God's grace, and more, too. It has all paid off. Your studying, for now, is done. We hope you can finally make some time to enjoy some fun. Always remember, life is a learning journey, so keep filling your mind with all that is worthy. May the happiness you feel today be a feeling you keep as you go on your way. And may God's wisdom, love, and happiness go with you, so you may find true success in all you do. And if anyone asks you who you are, you tell them, you are a child of God. Amen.
Restoration Ministries appreciates your support. If you would like to return your tithes and offering or give a financial gift to our ministry, our banking details are as follows. HSBC Bermuda, Restoration Ministries, Seventh-day Adventist Church, account number 011-2411-06001. Please email transfer confirmations with contribution details to us at treasury@restorationbda.com. Thank you again for your continued support of Restoration Ministries.
Today we celebrate all those who have graduated this year. With some of you leaving us to go off to university, we just want to share some good money tips with you. Tip number one, money doesn't have a life. It cannot act on its own, it can't do good deeds on its own, and it cannot commit crimes.
Basically, money is neither good nor bad. Money can do only what you tell it to do. Money is not the root of all evil, but the love of money is the root of all evil.
Tip number two, when it comes to money, we will either worship wealth or worship God with our wealth. Choose to worship God with your wealth.
God desires our time and devotion. He knows that we will all come face to face with the temptation of money, which is why he speaks about it so often in the Bible.
Tip number three, God owns everything. All the gifts and talents we've been blessed with, every penny that you earn or accumulate, and all your worldly possessions belong to him.
God calls us to manage this money well on his behalf, to be good stewards, and he only requires 10% to be returned to him, and further calls us to freely give according to how he has blessed you.
We invite you to now give generously because we worship God through sharing our gifts, tithes, and offerings. For those viewing online, please see the banking information on the screen so that you can be a part of our giving. Deacons, please come forward as we prepare to give freely and return our tithe.
Let us pray. Dear Lord and Father, we thank you for every blessing, for your provision, grace, and mercy. Help us to be good stewards over all you have afforded us, to be faithful in returning our tithes and to give freely according to your blessings. We pray over every penny that is collected for you, that it may be used to further your work and glorify your name. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Let's do it. This is a real simple song, simple action. You can just clap like this. It's a song of instruction this morning. It says, everybody, clap your hands. Come on. Ladies, can you lead us?
We praise you, O Lord.
We magnify your name. Worship him.
We worship you, O Lord.
We magnify your name.
Magnify your name.
Come on, let's sing that all over the room. We praise you, O Lord.
We praise you, O Lord.
We magnify your
we
name.
Magnify your name.
Come on, have you come to worship him?
We worship.
going there. I see you singing.
Jesus will.
up right there. we'll be fighting all day long. Amen. Hallelujah. Have you come to worship the King? Have you come to honor his presence, acknowledge that he is real? And do you believe that he deserves all the praise, all the glory, all the worship that you can find within you? If you believe that, can we do that right now? Sing your own song to him. Come on, talk to him. He deserves it. He's worthy of the glory. He's worthy of this praise right now. Hallelujah, Jesus. We bless your name, God.
All of the glory belongs to you.
Sometimes when we sing this song, we just turn around and we say, he's a healer.
Yeah.
He's a healer. Jehovah Rapha. He's a healer. A provider. Now don't just sing about it. Can we do that? Can we give him what he deserves in this place? Come on up, the very best of our praise, the very best of our worship. Come on, he deserves it. Come from the rising of the sun to the going down of the very same. Come on, when I'm going through a valley or if I'm on a mountaintop, through the good times, through the bad times, he deserves it. All of the glory, all of the worship, all of the honor, all of the exaltation. Come on, we adore you tonight. We esteem you today, God. We lift you up high. Come on, the name of the Lord is high. Come on, his train is filling this temple. Can you worship him in what spirit and in truth? He deserves it. He deserves it. Hallelujah. Amen. You're a healer. You're a healer. A provider.
Morning, church. Justin Abbin is the son of Howard and Terry Abbin. He was born on June 4th, 2003, and is a blessing from God to his family and friends. He has preached for the Bermuda Conference Children's Ministry Camp Meeting, Bermuda Institute's 100 Men on Campus Day, and at various churches across Bermuda. Justin plays the saxophone and has an interest and love for tennis, basketball, cricket, and soccer. He also has a black belt in karate. One of his greatest hobbies to participate in is fishing. He is a great singer and loves a good debate. And if you're wondering, no, he doesn't back down. That is something that one can admire about Justin, especially with him as a follower of Christ. This is that he'll always stand up for whatever he believes in. Whether if he's 100 men deep or alone, he will continue to advocate for Christ. He is a recent graduate of the Bermuda Institute class of 2021, where he served as spiritual vice president. He will soon be walking the hallowed halls of Oakwood University. Yes, any Oakwoodites? Yes. To study accounting and business administration. Justin loves living for Jesus. His desire as a Christian man is to shine for Jesus in whatever capacity he can be used to witness to young men and women for the kingdom of God. Following the musical meditation from Silent Praise, we will hear the spoken word by Brother Justin Abbin.
Praise you and Happy Sabbath, church. Oh, that was dry. Happy Sabbath, church. Come on, give God all the praise and glory, right? Come on. For every mountain, I know all the graduating classes went through those mountains, but God still remained the same, and he took us to graduation day, and we're here now. Amen? I just want to thank Pastor Hendrickson again for inviting me to preach for, I call it my last sermon in Bermuda, but it might not be because, you know, these pastors make me come back on breaks. But I want to say thank you to Pastor, you know, the congregation, Mr. Simons, of course, and everyone. Thank you so much. You know, it's always a pleasure to be on the pulpit to speak for the Lord and have the Lord speak through you. You know, having the Lord speak inside of you is such a privilege anywhere you go, because it's such a warm experience for me. And of course, like Giao said in our introduction, you know, God is always present in me, and I always want to share God's love and ministry inside me, you know. But today, we celebrate all the graduates of 2021, from preschool level to university. I want to give yourselves a round of applause. Each one of you has finished your task and achieved the goal that was set before you. You know, before our class graduated, Mr. Simons and our class made this graduation song. Man, it was so beautiful. Everyone from class put together a lyric. We couldn't use every single piece of the lyrics, but we condensed it to create such a beautiful song. Now, let me see if I can remember how the song goes. Okay, it's time to say goodbye. Yes, yes, looking forward to the future. There's not a thing that we would change. It's finally over. On that last part of that song, though, of that lyric, sorry, was "It's finally over." And it stuck to me as we went through our graduation day, and it stuck to me as we went past the graduation day. It's finally over. 12th grade, high school, middle school, preschool, all those years we spent in school of that higher level, moving on to something better. And that line, "It's finally over," stuck to me so much that I thought to myself, is it actually over? Is our mission over? Is our life over? Just because high school is finished and all those years are finished, is it finally over? Which leads me to my sermon title today, which is, "We're Not Finished Yet." We're not finished yet. Bow your heads with me. Heavenly Father, Lord, use me. Holy Spirit, fill me. And Jesus, speak through me as I preach today for you. You receive all the glory and honor and praise. In the name of Jesus, I pray, amen. You know, if I stuck to "it's finally over" and agreed with it, the text would be 2 Timothy 4, verse 7. "I have fought a good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith," which is partially true with all the graduates here, but it's not finished yet. I'm sorry today that this text does not align with us presently. We still have a work to do. We still have a standard to live by and a God to trust in, a God to love and love for each other. You know, it says in 1 Corinthians 9, verse 24 to 27, "Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. So I do not run aimlessly." I mean, graduates, we do not run aimlessly. "I do not box as one beating the air, but I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified." You know, the difference between this race and a regular race is that a regular race has different competitors. But this race, this spiritual race, this race that determines the outcome of you being saved or not being saved, yea, being saved on the day of Jesus returning, this race is between your past self and the new and changed self through Jesus Christ and the work of the Holy Spirit. The race to salvation. But before you can complete the race, you first have to understand your journey. Did you say journey, Justin? Yes, I said journey. The journey and the race are both have the same starting point, but only the race has a finish line. No, this journey is an everlasting journey. Now, I don't want to burden you with such a long-winded journey that sounds so long and, you know, it sounds so dreary. No, just hear me out. Hear me out. The journey is everlasting, but it's broken down into two distinct different pieces. The race being one, which is your salvation on earth, and life after Jesus returns is your second part. Can you tell me about this journey, Justin? Yes, I can tell you about this journey. We're on a journey, everyone. This journey, I want to tell you what it's called. It's called relationship. We tend to get confused by the idea that this life is where we complete our journey. One of the main reasons for this misunderstanding is of what we're supposed to complete. Many feel that their journey is to be a good person on earth, do good deeds. Others feel that their journey is to make it to heaven. Some even feel that their journey is to complete when they inherit everlasting life. However, this is not the case. You know, as a little child at Bermuda Institute, first grade, second grade, I would always pray during prayers in class that we can go to heaven, to have an eternal life, to have that amazing, spectacular award. It wasn't until I moved to Texas that I finally understood what the main understanding was for my journey to be made complete. I was in this Bible class, and the topic was righteousness. It was a multiple choice question quiz. And you know me being Bible man and everything, I was just rolling through the answers. But it was just this one multiple choice question that stuck to me because I got it wrong and I was so perplexed. The question was related to us following the law, Jesus, and righteousness. And I had put down the answer as that we can become righteous by keeping the law and doing what is right. Although this is a popular ideology, it is extremely false. We are already lawbreakers by nature. We are already sinners. We were born in it. We were shaped in it. And if you agree with that ideology, that means your journey hasn't even started yet. You're going backwards from the starting point. The realization of it is that we don't keep the law to inherit righteousness. We keep the law because Jesus is our righteousness, and we want to show that we love him and we want him. Our journey is about having a deep and intimate relationship with Jesus, which will only last forever. He is the only righteousness that we can ever receive on this earth. He was the one who pardoned us from death, from eternal separation from God. He took on sin by himself and bore it all on the cross so that you could receive him in your heart and mind. We are saved by his righteousness, amen? The goal is to have the most uttermost and deep relationship with Jesus. That's what your journey is all about. But the problem for many people, for many Christians, for many Seventh-day Adventists, is that many of us tend to dictate and tell Jesus their own journey. Many are too busy determining how their journey should go, too busy maneuvering in different paths counter to what Jesus had designed. Listen now, so much to the point that people really determine for themselves when their journey ends or if it has ended. You know, I used to think that way too. I can determine my fate, but no, that's not true. People say, oh, I'm saved. Jesus loved me, and that's all I need. Oh, I'm saved by grace, and that's all I need to live my life by. Yeah, I'm not really, I really have a good relationship with God already, so there's nothing else I need to do. Man, can I tell you a secret about this journey and completing the goal? The journey never ends. The relationship can only grow deeper and deeper, just like a father and son has a relationship with other, and only can get deeper and deeper. Don't you ever feel content in the space where you are? You start to feel more holy than everyone else, feel more sanctified, feel more entitled to the second row in the front of the church for no one else, just you. Looking down on everyone because you feel you have some great relationship with Jesus and everyone should admire you and your great job. Man, do you want a cookie or would that mess up your Seventh-day Adventist diet that you have? Man, that is not it. None of us have ever, I mean ever, have reached that position of being so holy and having such a perfect relationship with God. That would actually mean that you are in oneness with God and the Godhead and in completeness with him, that you're perfect. Newsflash, no one is perfect. Man, you're only alive because of the grace of Jesus, and now you want to carry on like you're some bona fide saint? If I do recall, we are all started off poorly with Jesus. We all rejected him. We all fell short and have fallen short of the glory of God. And your relationship with Jesus was poor in the beginning. Jesus made faith and salvation possible by you. Let Jesus be bonafide, not you. I'm telling you guys that the journey shall never end, even after God says, well done, thy good and faithful servant. You know, a great downfall to making heaven your main goal is that your journey is that being faithful to God on earth is necessary, but when you go to heaven, you think you can just lay back and be catered to. Oh, I completed my goal. Hey, mom, I'm in heaven. Can you see me? No, that's not how it works. It's the relationship. It's the relationship. It's the relationship. I don't know how much to tell you. especially in this day and age. Why would you not want to build a deep relationship with the only person that could save you? With the only person that died for your salvation? For the only one that can make you a new creation? Did we go to school every day like we paying for our own tuition, knowing well we had a guardian paying for us? Did we teach ourselves the things that we learned from young to where we are now? Well, I hope not. Anyway, but it's the same with Jesus. Jesus has paid our debts and wiped our slate clean. Now, let's get to the sweet part. By craving a deeper relationship with Jesus and spending time with him, the work that he designed for you to do on earth has become easier than before. His purpose is revealed to you like never before. You start to see things differently. You start to feel more bold, this holy boldness that you have. You start to do things with joy, and you know you can encounter someone and experience, share your experiences with them with so much enthusiasm and power because you love Jesus and you crave that relationship with him and you want to show him that you love me. And you know, it says in the Bible, if you love me, well, man, only if you know that, okay. That's all right. And though the journey for the most deep relationship with Jesus will never end, the race will be short. And you will understand that your journey is long and you know what your journey is all about. And needless to say, guys, again, that the race is not against each other. It is against the new you. And the new you is the only one that can receive Jesus in your heart and make it the prerogative to live for him. You can finish the race. Don't worry about your struggles. You will finish the race. Don't worry about your difficulties. You will finish your race. There's bills that you have to pay. You will finish the race. Don't worry about your storms that pass over you. You will finish the race. The rain that will make you slip up sometimes. You will finish the race. Don't worry about sometimes that people might finish before you and you might see people filled with the Holy Ghost before you. No, just get there. You will finish the race. Don't worry how messed up you was in the past, how broken you was, how much of a sinner you was, all that you have said and done. Don't let that hold you back because you still will finish the race. Just remember your relationship. Remember your journey. Jesus paid it all for you. Just remember the reason for your journey, and you shall finish the race. You know, I have a story I told a while ago. It was, man, I don't know, probably like 6 years ago. I don't know if you guys, I used to catch the bus, and there was this bus I used to catch every single day to school and back. It was the number 11 route. Oh, man, but one day, say one day. One day, the number 11 didn't come into B.I.'s parking lot. Oh, boy. And I didn't know what to do. And I didn't have a phone at the time. I didn't even know what to do. So I had a teacher that told me, just catch the Hamilton bus, and you can hop on the next bus to your house. And I was like, okay. I didn't know what to do. I was panicking because, you know, my 11 bus is messing up my routine every day. My dad will come to the aquarium. I'll get on the number 11 bus, stop at the aquarium. He'll pick me up. Hi, Dad. How was your day, son? It was looking different today. Man, so I hopped on the Hamilton bus, and, you know, the teacher says someone will look after me, have a guardian, a 12th grader. Man, that 12th grader went to the back of the bus, left me alone. I was sitting in the front, had my legs crossed with my arms around, like, I didn't know what else to do. I felt so alone. I saw people I've never seen before from Work Academy and different schools, and I was getting scared, like, are they going to do something to me? I started praying inside my mind. I didn't know what to do. Man, I finally got to town. I looked around to see if I saw anyone I knew. Like, how am I supposed to? I'm just praying. Like, come on, God. Show me. My daddy just knew that I was going to be in town. And I'm looking for his car. Man. And I had to walk. And I was walking, trying to get my way home. Walking, walking on this journey. Walking, walking, walking. And I thought to myself, look, maybe I could stop at my mama's job. So I ran dashing to my mama's job. Yes, I found a way. I'm smart. I'm good. Then, no, look. Then I remembered that my mom went away the day before. Oh, my goodness. So I'm like, what is going on? And I'm walking. And I'm walking. I've got this. And my mom and dad are known to give me these big suitcases, bags on my back. So, and I've got this big water bottle. Man, you know, the water bottle is empty. So I'm walking. I said, oh. There's this big hill to Hamiltonian. If you know where Hamiltonian is, there's this big hill going up. You know, my grandma lives up there. I said, maybe if I can go there, I can go to my grandma. But, you know, I said to myself, I'm not walking up this big hill. I'm already tired. You know, there's a 50-50% chance that she's home or she would hear me knock on the door because, you know, she's up in the air. She might be sleeping. So I'm walking on North Shore. I'm walking. Yes, that's where I'm all the way on North Shore, walking. The journey is long. Man, I'm looking around to see if I know my surroundings. I said, okay, I know here. To see her. Okay, I'm getting close. I'm getting breathing. Yes, poor sight. Goodness gracious. And, you know, I finally get to this old barbershop where my Uncle Ricky used to cut, Ricky Spence used to cut, yes, all the way there. You know, it's a Monday, and his barbershop isn't open on Mondays. Oh, man. So, you know, I'm panicking. I'm sitting down. I took a break, sat down. You know, I went to check if God put some water in my bottle, you know. I still put it, you had a little drop, and went put my tongue out, man. You know, that didn't help. I kept walking. I finally, after 20 minutes, the sun's setting, get to Sarah's gas station. Oh, man, yes, a long walk, and I thought I was making it, and I was about to come to my dad crying, and I made it, God. This journey was long. Man, but someone saw me, and my aunt, man, don't forget the name, Justin. I just thought about this before. Aunt Paula. Thank you. Thank you so much, Daddy. Aunt Paula, and I didn't call her Aunt Paula then. I just knew her as Zayden's grandma, and she was like, excuse me, you're from BI? And I'm wearing the BI uniform. I said, yes, I'm from BI. And he's like, are you okay? I said, well, I missed my bus, but that's not the truth. I didn't know what bus to catch. And I just didn't want to seem like I was some lost child and then be sent to the police station and everything like that. And, you know, she said, come on, I'm going to drop her and my grandson. I'll take you home. Oh, do you just believe I was running across the street to her running, you know, slow motion. Dun, 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 you know. Man, and it just felt so long. It felt so winded. The journey felt so long, and I felt so burdened. And finally, God sent my guardian angel and Aunt Paula to sweep me up, and I finally got home, and I saw my dad. I called my dad in the car, told him, Daddy, I'm coming home. I'm coming home. And he said, okay, son, I'm coming. And he went to we was at the front of the house, and, you know, Aunt Paula told my daddy, this is your son? Yes, this is my son. And I came running to my daddy. I fell to the ground, and, like I was at Jesus' feet, and holding my dad. Yeah, I was tired. And I was like, he was like, it's okay, boy. It's okay, son. It's all right. And I went upstairs. My dad catered to me, gave me water, made me feel so good. And I'm here crying. You know, I could have stopped crying, but I love the attention. But I felt so faint. I felt so tired. I felt so worn. And, you know, that's how it is in your journey in life, you know. We go through different things. We go different trials. It's not always going to be perfect. It's not going to always be easy. But I don't think we've come this far for God to leave us. He will always be there for us, strengthening us and guiding us and counseling us. You know, God was counseling me to the different places. Even though I wasn't there, he gave me the barrenness of my mom's job and my grandma and, you know, Uncle Rick, all those people that has been there for me before. You know, they weren't there before, but God was still there. And I still walked and walked. And God's trying to tell you, just keep walking in your journey. Keep walking with him. You might fall short. You might have the rain. You might have the storms in life. You might have those difficulties. But God will send someone. He will send something to tell you that he'll make something out of nothing. Even if you feel so faint and feel so worn, he still got you in his arms. He still has you. Don't let go of his hand. Keep walking. You might not see him sometimes. Just keep walking. You will finish that race. The journey is long and it's not swift, but the race is, if you just know what the journey is all about, your relationship, that deeper and deeper relationship with God. You know, the next day, I didn't want to go to school, and then I went crying to my dad again, Daddy, I'm still tired. He said, son, you don't have to go to school today. You know, I felt so joyful. And, you know, you can testify about these things because the day after, I went to school and I testified what I went through, and I shared my testimony of what experiences of walking my legs. And I was pretty chubby then, so, you know, I wasn't fit. I had these big chubby cheeks. And, you know, my Uncle Canal and Cameron Caleb and I used to call myself Nitsaj, the opposite of me from now, because I was a very chubby boy, you know. So I was very tired, and I shared that testimony of what I went through. And Jesus always remained in control. You know, it says in Acts 20, verse 24, but I do not account my life for any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course in the ministry that I have received from the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace. The gospel is good, everyone. The gospel would include just difficulties and trials, but it is the testimony with it. It's all about Jesus and what Jesus has done for you. He died for you on that cross. That's one thing that has done for you, and he's still leading you to his throne now. Even if you weren't called to be a pastor, an elder, or minister of music, deacon, usher, director, community service, you know, social director, all those titles. You know, if you haven't caught it, let your life be a living testimony. Let your light so shine before man. Let that be the gospel of Jesus for you, to show others who Jesus is inside of you. Let the world know around you how you live and what is only possible by understanding your journey, that your journey is for Christ. You know, Pastor Ken's told us in class that Christianity isn't religion, it's a lifestyle. It isn't just a belief, it is a lifestyle. It's how you live your life. And you can only know that through your journey. You know, Philippians 1 verse 6 says, "And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at that day of Jesus Christ." 12th graders that, well, actually alumni, you know, middle schoolers who finished 8th grade, kindergartners, preschoolers, and people all the way up in university. He has begun to work in us, but it's not finished yet. We need to keep walking, keep moving forward in relationship with God. He will lead you to your purpose. He will create, he turn your pain into purpose. He will make everything new for you, and he will bring you to alignment with what he has called you to do. Just hold his hand, keep walking, and remember the journey he has sent for you. You know, another thing about journey, I like to go fishing, of course, and every morning I like to wake up, well, not every morning, that's kind of stretching it. Every Sunday morning I like to wake up. And you might think I'm crazy for this, but I like to wake up at 4 in the morning to go fishing with my Uncle Princeton. But it was at one time, the first time I went, I was still a chubby boy and, you know, I was still carrying a lot of weight. And I was so excited to go fishing the next day, Sunday morning fishing. And my uncle picked me up. I didn't have no rest because I get anxious. I get anxiety. I feel like I'm sleeping for 8 hours, but it's actually for 20 minutes. And I wake up and look at the time, and I see it's 12 o'clock, and it went to 12 o'clock to 12:20. Woke up again, it's at 1 o'clock. So I was, you know, I try to put on some Christian music to relax myself. I feel myself going to sleep. And then someone's like, "Oh, you're going to miss it. You're going to miss out." And I wake up again at 2 o'clock. You know, but this time, I'm sleeping, and I had the AC on, and I'm ready for the next day. My daddy woke me up. "Time to go fishing, Justin. Go with your uncle." My dad doesn't really like me going on this rock, because they're very slippery. I can't tell you where my secret spot is, but we catch a lot of fish. You know, you can DM me if you want some fish. I can hook you up, but that's precisely the point. You know, but I'm going with my uncle Princeton, right? And he was taking me for my first time going fishing. And, you know, I thought it was a race. I was running, trying to race against my uncle. You know, I always raced against my daddy, who can catch the most fish. But, you know, I upgraded from the fish. I used to just catch breams and chubs and white grunts. But when I ran to my Uncle Princeton, well, man, it was 6 o'clock. He was catching the bait, and he finally said, "Okay, you can throw your line out." I put a pilcher on my line, and I threw it out. I caught my first snapper. I wanted to wake my dad up and tell him, "Oh, I caught my first snapper. You never had me catch you with this." And I was so excited. I was like, I was catching 1, 2, 3. And my uncle hasn't even caught one yet. And I was like, I'm beating him. I'm doing good. My dad's going to be proud of me when I get him. And I'm fishing. And we go over to the backside of my spot. And I'm still not going to tell you where it is. And I'm fishing. But all of a sudden, I see my uncle reckoning on 1, 2, skip a few, like 20-something fish, and I'm still got my 3. And I'm like, "Well, what about me?" And his still reckoning fish. And he said, "Oh, this is old school. This is class. Like, you ain't got these skills like me." I'm like, okay. I'm getting upset now. I'm like, and I thought I had an advantage, so I started praying, "Lord, let me catch more fish than my uncle. Let him show that I still have the better skills than him." That was the worst thing to do, because Uncle Steele started reckoning more and more fish. And I had 4. And I was like, "Oh, man, I'm only going to take him 4 fish. And my uncle has 25. Man, and the race wasn't looking good for me. And I was like, my uncle's like, "This ain't a race. This is something between you and I. We're going to share this." You know, sometimes in life we race against Jesus to compare ourselves to Jesus, saying, "Okay, I'm as holy as him. I can be like him." And that's the problem that Satan had in the beginning, trying to be like Jesus so much that we can be over him, be on top of him, and have his throne, and that we can be just like him without him even being in our lives, that we can race against him. And that's our old nature racing against Jesus and our new created self that is trying to be more like Jesus without Jesus in our lives. And we're trying to be more sanctified and more holy without even Jesus in our hearts. We don't even think about him. We just think, "Oh, I can be like him. I don't need him. I can live my life without him. I can go through the journey without him. I don't need him. I don't need your hand. I don't need you to walk by me. I can go through life all by myself. Make my wealth, make my prosperity, make anything I need. I'll be successful without you." But that's not how it is. We need Jesus. You know, when I came, and after that fishing time, we came home, and I had the 4 fish, and he had the 24. He said, "Hey, Justin, we're going to split the filet. You can have this big and have that big." Oh, I was so relieved. I couldn't lie, though, because he cleaned the fish right in front of my daddy. I would tell my daddy, this is how much fish I caught, and this is how much fish my uncle caught. But, you know, he watched, and it's just like Jesus, you know. He is there, and he shares his love with us. He doesn't race against us. He doesn't compare himself to us and say that he's so righteous over us. He's still humble, and he still serves us and still caters to us, even in our dirt, even in our trials and tribulations that we go through. Even if we turn our backs on him, he still shares his love with us, and he still chastens for us, fights for us, that reckless love that he has for us. So that's why we need to go on that journey with him. Remember that journey. It's for a deep relationship with the one that saved us. His Savior, the Redeemer, the lover of all things, the rock of my salvation, every single thing that he is for us, he can be for you too. Just remember your journey, and you remember that your race can be finished if you just remember what you're called to do, and that's just to have a deeper relationship with God. And as the music comes forward, I just want to let you know today, don't ever let your journey be a burden to you. You will have burdens in life, but don't ever think that Jesus has put you in a position where having a relationship with him is so tiresome and long-winded, and, you know, reading your Bible is so boring, and praying to him is, you know, it's just terrible. It's not. Break through it. That's your old nature fighting against you in your race to salvation, to Jesus. Just trust in him. Trust that Jesus had made a path for your journey. And it will be so sweet to know that even after he says, well done, thy good and faithful servant, he is still not through with you. He will still spend time with you. Come to you, knocking on your mansion, saying, look, let me spend time with you. Let's eat. Let's sup together. Let's talk. He's always going to be there with you. Just make it your priority to be there with him. Make it your priority to have a relationship with him. You can, and even if you haven't even started your journey yet, you can come boldly to his grace, to his throne of grace, that you may attain his mercy and find grace to help yourself in a time of need. Hebrews 4, verse 16. That you can come to him gracefully broken. You can come to him full of your dirt, full of your pain, and he will clean you up and say, I'm got you, Justin. So this song, I will sing this song for the appeal. Just listen to this song. Take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire. Okay, help me out.
Just lift up your hands.
Stand up with me if you may. Because God has a journey for you. God has a plan for your life. No matter what you go through, no matter what your experiences that you've been through, God still says he has a journey set before you. Trust him. You can come to him gracefully broken and believe that he is still King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is the restorer of all things. This is restoration, where love is such a joy and the experience is real. Come on. But that's Hamilton Church. But come on. Come on. Jesus is still the maintainer of all things. Come to him gracefully broken, and he still is in control. Remember the relationship. Remember the journey.
My heart stands in awe of your name. Your mighty love stands strong
to the end.
You will fulfill
your
purpose in me. Sing it out, church.
Arms wide open.
Pouring out.
My life.
Gracefully broken. Come on, can we lift that chorus again?
Here I am.
Arms wide open.
Yeah.
chorus one more time. Here I am.
Here I am, God.
Arms wide open.
Arms wide open.
Pour my love on you.
Pouring out my life.
Gracefully broken.
Gracefully broken.
Yeah. You know, if you feel this way, you know, if all the difficulties you've been through and hearing the song, you know, I just want you to lift your voice. Lift your voice. It's just inside of you. Just say, I surrender all.
Yeah.
Oh, I surrender all. And all to thee, my blessed Savior, rise up. I surrender all. Oh, I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all.
Oh, I surrender all.
I can't hit that.
I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all.
Do you surrender all today? Do you believe him? Do you receive him? Do you make him your journey and believe that he has a calling for your life and trust him and believe in him, that his relationship will be strong if you just trust in him? Bow your heads with me and close your eyes. Lord, we surrender all today, Lord. All our voices lifted up. All our eyes are lifted up to you. Our hearts are lifted up. We come gracefully broken to you, Lord. For the King of Kings and Lord of Lords you are. We are nothing to you. You are everything to us. And by you, by nothing plus everything equals everything, Lord. So we add you to our lives to make us everything, Lord. That you can become our righteousness in us. That we can live for you and live for you. And we can have a relationship with you. Let our journey be long, that our race can be short, and our salvation will be inheritance to us. Thank you for everything that you blessed us with. And even in this moment right now, we have our hands lifted up and say, Jesus, we love you. Jesus, we praise you. And Jesus, we believe in you. And we can't wait till you return again. Lord, renew in us a clean heart and give us a new mind. And Lord, we want to have a new temple for you that you can live inside of us and minister through us. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Can the church say amen one more time, please? We want to thank Brother Eben for giving us that very sound and appropriate word for today. We want to thank all of our participants, all the youth that participated in today's program. We want to thank all the ministries and the hard work they put into this service to have everything fall into place. So we want to say thank you. And we want to say to our graduates, whether you will be here on the island or leaving, just as my mother told me, you are never too grown to come back home. So when you are on the island, make sure that you stop in to say hello to your family here at Restoration. We will pray for you. We will celebrate with you. We will laugh with you. We will cry with you. Whatever you need, know that your family here at Restoration will support you. All right, so we have a few quick announcements, and then we will get out of here. There are a few birthdays and anniversaries that are taking place. Lene, I know she had a birthday this week. We have Ricardo Campbell. Anne-Marie and Paul Simons are celebrating an anniversary this month. Also, we have Heather and Dennis Lister as well, who are celebrating an anniversary this month. Amen. Remember that this Tuesday, Super Tuesday, the speaker is Pastor Roger Bernard, so make sure you look out for that link. And the next week, we will have Pastor James Duggett Jr. here and the Cornerstone My Ministry. So please make sure you are in the building next week. Remember that we have Safe Space every morning at 9 a.m. and then Church at Study at 9:30. Remember that Children's Ministry will be running at 12. And also a community service. If you are ready to do some outreach, they are starting this afternoon. So Carrie said that you can meet with them at 2:30 in the parking lot. So if you are ready to do some ministry and get out there, they are meeting today at 2:30. And lastly, if you would like to get involved in a ministry, whether that's a worship coordinator, media personnel, usher, or children's ministry, please make sure that you see April Mall, Owen Simons, Linton Miller, or Willie Ferguson. So we are going to close out with our mission statement. So if you could put that on the screen. So Restoration Ministries exists to provide a spiritually safe and open environment in which to restore, nurture, and maintain an intimate relationship with Jesus Christ, equipping all for service. And three times, we are
Restoration.
We are
Restoration.
Who are we?
Restoration.
All right, be blessed. Remember, there is a reception for the graduates in the back. It's a small reception. Keep that in mind, but that is for our graduates. Be blessed.
Yeah. Have you guys had a good day in Jesus? Yeah. Come on. Yeah.
Say right there, Jesus be a fence.
protection. I need protection. Protection. You're free to leave. Protection. Along the way. Protection. 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 Along the way. 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 Say Jesus, be a fence.
Jesus, be a fence.
Be a fence right now.
Jesus, be a fence.
But I'm gonna keep on going if you're here. Yeah, protection.
Protection.
You can leave if you want to.
Protection.
Protection.
Protection.